Yeah, thank you for the fine introduction. So some of you may already know me from the first AIDD school. But I can present myself anyway. I'm a PhD student also in the lab of Yves. And one of the topics I'm working on is this topic I will present today. The other topic was all what I was working on that's already presented in the previous days is the Melody project I was also heavily involved in. But today it will be this topic. So let me see if this works. Not yet, because I, of course. Okay. Yeah, now it works. We go back. So the presentation of today will be in two parts. So first of all, the first part will be about the research on optical chemical structure recognition and the relation with object detection. And I hope then to have some time to introduce or to give you some practical guidelines on weights and biases, because all the experiments for this research was we used this tool, and maybe it can be for use for you, maybe to organize, because you will probably also do some experiments, and it can maybe help you with your research also. So to begin this lecture, it's about, so 2 years ago, more or less, we published ChemGrapher. It's a tool to recognize chemical structure from 2D images. So you have these typical drawn chemical structures in a paper or in literature, and the idea is then that this tool can recognize this and translate it to maybe a smiles. I think in the first AIDD school there was also a talk from Oko that also had their team also did some work on this topic. So yes, let's say 2 years ago there were not a lot of machine learning tools on this to do this task, but yeah, they're fastly growing, so it's a fast growing field, so it's good that we dive into more details how it works. So maybe the motivation of doing this or to recognize this chemical structure is because, in a lot of literature, these chemical structure, so literature about new drugs, for example, the small molecules or even bigger molecules maybe can be represented in a format that is a 2D image. And of course, if you want to do some data mining on this literature, text you can already more or less process, but images or recognize this graph structure, I mean, it's a challenging task. So we try to tackle this task with a tool, because these formats like smiles or other formats, they can be used in further pipelines in for machine learning. So that's the basic idea. So ChemGrapher, what it basically does is it will translate the 2D image to a graph structure. So the aim is to have the graph structure. Of course, if you have a smiles, you also know the graph structure. But what we also provide is the location. Okay, now it doesn't work anymore. Anyway, the pointer doesn't work. So the locations of every node in this graph, you can also locate them, or you have the coordinates of the original location in the original image. So if you have, for example, an error on one of these nodes, you can backtrack it. Okay, I made an the or the tool made an error on this part of the image. So that gives some inter yeah it gives some possibility to interpret the model, like, okay, on these kind of atoms the model is still having some difficulties. So that's one plus. Of course, maybe let's first dive in what the complete method does. So it's split up in different steps. So first it will, for every segment in the image, do a segmentation. So you have atom segments, you have bond segments, and you have charge segments. So the first line on the top is the atom pipeline, then you have the bond pipeline, and then you have the charge pipeline. And then after this step, after this segmentation step, you have a classification step that classifies all these segments in a more or less smart way, because depending on which atom is recognized, you then also combine different in this next bond classification pipeline, you will check for what are the possible bonds between all these atoms in a specific radius, and then it will classify each possible bond and it predicts these bonds separately, and then combining all these predictions, it will be the input for a graph building algorithm, and then the ending, the output of the whole pipeline is then a graph structure, which you can translate, of course, to a SMILES. You all know how SMILES works. So when you have this, you have everything what you need to describe the molecule. But one, so you have this segmentation step. And for the segmentation step, you also need to know, you have some need to have labels for on instance level. So you need to know the location of every atom or every bond in the image. So what did we do? Because this is not widely available, these kind of labels. You have most of the cases it's an image of a molecule, and then as a label it's just the SMILES. So what did we do? We generated these kind of images with RDKit. So we made a modification of RDKit. When so you give SMILES, and then you can with RDKit you transform it to an image. You can add some information about the style or the fonts of the labels for the atoms. And then we modified it this way that it also provides labels for the location where RDKit draws all the atoms and the bonds. So that's how we created the labels for ChemGrapher. And then we, at the time, we benchmarked against OSRA. OSRA is an open source tool, but it's a rule-based tool. And then if you take the vanilla performance just using the generated images by RDKit, that comes of course with its specific RDKit style, of course you can add a lot of other styles like bond length or bond width to make it more generalizable, but at a specific specific point it will stop. You cannot cover all the possible styles in the literature, so you're limited to this domain of RDKit, but still you get a fairly good performance. It's the blue bar, but OSRA is still better it's a data set that is available. It's these are scanned images. And then, but if you if you just label 40 images from this data set, you pick randomly 40, and then you label them manually, of course, because you have no option, it will boost performance already to 83, which is better than OSRA. So it's, you see that it has some disadvantage to use these kind of labels, because you need them, it's difficult to find, but once you have them, it can boost really performance on your maybe target domain where your domain of interest. So I already summed up all the drawbacks. So you need these labels. Let's go to the next slide. Maybe interesting connect. Yeah, sorry, there is a question. So these labels, maybe I can go back to this slide. So yeah, I don't have a pointer, but you have the smiles of this image, for example, and then the label. Ah. Yeah. So, so you need to, of course, hand label them because you don't have them. You have only the smiles. But yeah, you can with some image tools pick the right coordinates of the atoms. So it's really a hard process to point to the atom, all the atoms in the image. So that's really what I mean with labeling these kind of images. So all the coordinates from all the atoms in the image. Yeah. So maybe interesting related work is then object detection, because in object detection, what the end goal is to locate every object here, for example, every car or every person, motorcycle, whatever object you are interested in. But again, in object detection, not always you have the locations. Maybe you have some information like, okay, there is a car in this image, but you don't know where it is. There is a person in this image, but you don't know where it is. And then, of course, there are now weakly supervised object detection methods that can use this information still to improve on localizing all the objects in the image. So it's related. And then the idea, of course, so it's related, and that's why we also wanted to develop a method that can also improve on this task, but also on the task of localizing the atoms in the image, which we then assume they're just objects on the image, but we don't have the information about the location, and we still want to be able to train ChemGrapher, for example, or other type of methods that rely on the locations, because there is a recently accepted paper for NeurIPS 2022 that did some experiments, because nowadays they categorize the two chemical structure image recognition methods in two categories. So first is a category that starts from a CNN encoder or encoder in general encoder decoder structure that just uses at one end the labels, just the smiles, for example, or other kinds of representation, and on the other hand you have the image. So they just try to train this CNN encoder decoder structure, and then on the other end you have also, so the red block, you have first that's more the ChemGrapher approach, let's say, that you first recognize all the different chemical entities, is how they call it, in the image, and then on top of that you can have different approaches again to finally convert them to a graph. And then they did some experiments, and then they I don't have the pointer here, but maybe I can just summarize that they did some experiments with all these different approaches. You also have rule-based approaches, of course, that was not on the previous slide. That's more the OSRA style. And then you have this CNN or encoder-decoder structure, and then you have the chemical entity detection.
So,
Ah, the R, okay. Okay. So, yeah, so some methods don't handle them well. So that's indeed, but you can see them as just a different type of atom. Then they will be put like an R group in the resulting smiles. But some methods cannot handle them. Yeah. Okay. So what they did was to benchmark, let's say in general, the different approaches. And one conclusion that they got from it was that if you benchmark with the encoder decoder approach with 1 million data points and the chemical entity detection approach with 10k data points or samples, and then even with 10k you get you see here the blue, you get on different data sets a better accuracy. So the metric that is evaluated here is just the accuracy of the number of or a percentage of images that was completely correct, for the complete graph was correct. That's here the metric. So you one conclusion that you can see is that okay, with even a small data regime, you can have a good performance. So that's why we were motivated to also, we already knew it, but it was just really accepted now, but if we're already motivated to dive more in this approach. So what I said is to give a solution for weakly supervised object detection. And we try to approach it with probabilistic programming. So for example, here you have a source domain where you have already a good performance. So in the top example, you have maybe want to, this is just a toy example, of course, you want to locate the different digit in an image, but you only have access to a specific you only have, for example, the digits 0 to 6 in your training data set, but you want to perform to test it on a target domain where you also have digits like 8, like 9, like 7. It didn't see it in source domain, so it will probably fail in classifying these objects. But what if you have some information about in the source domain, like in these toy examples, you have for all these images in this target domain, the sum of digits. Of course, you don't have the location of every digit individually, but you have the sum in total. Can you still use this information to fine-tune your object detection model? That's a little bit the idea come back to the chemical structure recognition. The same can be can be the case here, that you have specific number of atoms in your source domain, but you want to perform or test it on a target domain where you have maybe like R group or like other atoms. Can you still fine tune your object detection model with some information like a smiles and even not the exact locations of these new atoms? That's the motivation. So what we did was to put like a probabilistic reasoning framework on top of an object detection model. So you have this first object detection model trained on a source domain. We extract like we extract this object detection model, and we adapt it so that it can fit to this probabilistic reasoning framework, so that at the end it will get predictions for the box notations and of course for the box, so the bounding boxes of every atom or every digit in the object, let's say in general, in the image. And then at the end you also have the class that is together with every box or bounding box in this object. Okay, what we fix here is the bounding box prediction pipeline, and what we make trainable is the classifier that is comes together with this object detection new backbone, and then we make a probabilistic framework on top so that it can reason on, okay, what are the number of true atoms in this image, or what is the sum of this of the digit in the image, and then it can backpropagate this loss to the classifier, so only the classifier will be trained, and then you can fine-tune your object detection model. So how does the probabilistic reasoning work? So let's to get everybody on up to speed, or to synchronize everybody. So in general, probabilistic logical reasoning, you can represent or use as knowledge representation in the form of probabilistic facts or probabilistic rules, and it can then encode some uncertainty in this knowledge. So for example, of a probabilistic fact is that Alice and Bob will each pass their exam with a probability of 50% or 0.5. And then a logical rule can be that if both Alice and Bob pass their exam, they will host a party. So then you can do inferences on this knowledge that you represented with these probabilistic rules and facts. And then your query can be, for example, okay, what is now the probability that Alice and Bob will host a party? So then the inference is that you sum over all the probable worlds that according the rules, of course, so that the query is true. And then by summing all the probabilities of all these probable worlds, you will get the probability of this. So maybe we can just do it for this simple example. So what are the all the probable worlds so that the party will be true? So you have let's just sum all the probable worlds. So you have Alice passes exams and Bob passes exams, or Alice not passes exam, Bob not passes exam, and so on. And then some of these worlds translates to a party or no party. So in this case, the only probable or possible worlds that give a party is that Alice and Bob passes their exams both, and then you can just calculate the probability, and then you have an answer to your query. So this can be done. So what we now did manually, this can be done in some probabilistic frameworks automatically that does this summing for you. I won't go into details of all these because there can be several of them, but this is what at the back will be done. So it's summing over all probable worlds. So then by summing over all the probable worlds, calculate the possibility, calculate a loss, you can backpropagate this to the classifier, and then adapt your backbone to outputting new probabilities that better fit the data. What we also did, so you can then first fine tune your object detection model, but what if you now do some kind of iterative relabeling? So now that you have a new object detection model, you can create some bounding boxes, and then you can use these bounding boxes now as pseudo labels to retrain the whole object detection from scratch again. This was also proposed by some other persons that also did some weakly supervised object detection. What we also did was, when you create the pseudo labels, we also check for the correctness of the query, because if it's not correct, we don't take the pseudo label, because it can create noise because then probably the bounding boxes are also not correct. So then we remove this noise, and then you can retrain, and you can do it iteratively. So with this new object detection model, you can even fine tune again, or I mean, this is an iterative structure or method that you can use to further update your object detection model. We did some experiments. So we first took as query the number of the number of classes of individual classes in your image. So we took two data sets. They're the clever mini data sets and this molecule data set. For the clever mini data set, you have objects like spheres, like cylinders, but also cubes that is not in this image. And then for the molecule data sets, the objects we try to detect are the individual atoms, or carbon, nitrogen, and so on. And then what you have as labels is the number of each of these individual objects in the image. From the molecule data set, you can easily extract it from the smiles. You know the number of atoms. So that was the idea, to at least use the smiles also to train our object detection model. And then we benchmarked against some baselines models. So one of the baseline we got from a cell counting by regression used a convolutional neural network. That's the first baseline. And on top, we did some class activation mapping to localize also the objects. And then the other was a more state-of-the-art weakly supervised object detection model that is also using this iteratively method I just show you. And this was the other benchmark or baseline we used to benchmark against. And then, without diving into all the details, I just want to show you that, okay, on these two data sets, we get a better performance than the baselines. The only difference is that the first regression baseline was better in the mole counting accuracy. So where the output, you only are just interested in the number of atoms, the correct number of atoms in the image. This accuracy was better, but then it fails on out of the main. So the approach that detects all the individual entities was shown to be more generalizable than this regression model. And then we did some other experiments, checking the time here, because the probabilistic framework can also, you're free to use other types of weak supervision, which is not always the case with other weakly supervised object detection. You're fixed with a specific type of weak supervision. Most of the cases is just the presence or the absence of a specific object in the image. But what if you have other type of supervision? For example, you know maybe a ranges of class counts in your image. You have a one cylinder, and you know there at least multiple spheres in the image, and you want to exploit this information in your model, you can do it with this method. Or then, for example, the sum of digits in your image, there is also some more complex weak supervision where you need to know how to count digits and so on. So this is also possible. So we did some experiments with these and we used the same baselines. Some of the baselines, I mean, in some of the cases, the baseline couldn't handle it. So then you see NA. For the ResNet 50 CAM, we adapted it a little bit so it can use the sum information for the digits, but still it was underperforming. So this was just to show you that even with other types of weak supervision, we still get a good performance. Maybe checking the time because I wanted to show you also the part two. Yeah, this was just to show that if you iteratively use the method, you can slowly improve performance So we did, we just here. So the conclusions. Because of the object detection models, you need this richly annotated images. There is a need for weakly supervised methods. That's what we proposed here. And it can also use weak supervision of arbitrary type. So it can other like summing, like ranges of counts, and it can get a good performance. So maybe before we go to the second part, we have some questions already for this part. That's because now we're still, but you can, we can also do it for the end if there's no new questions. So for the experiments, we there is a question.
Think about following. My mind is basically used PTO, like the actual data set, mind shot pattern. Also working on images, I assume. And wouldn't one elaborate vector measurements actually? Like ideally I would want to mine random papers and expect their reactions, because then I don't need to use the access.
Yeah.
How far away are we from that?
I think it's still, but it's indeed a step in the direction of this, because if you have this kind of information, of detailed information that you can recognize on the image, it's more easy, I think, or more reliable to translate it to a reaction than just, in a dumb way, just translate images to reactions, and then maybe there is some garbage that comes out.
Wouldn't one test if we can cover that from the patterns and see how good we are? Is that the gold standard of like reaction coverage?
So the question is, so
we kind of have the patterns and we know the expected reactions associated with the patterns. And the question kind of is, couldn't one use that like very standard, very how good we are with our methods?
Yeah, I think we can, but oh, sorry. So if we have the information about the patterns, so we have one the patterns, and then on the other side you have the reactions, could we just test the methods, how good we are in doing translating the image to a reaction? I think we can do it. I have not seen yet figures or numbers, but it's a good thing. We can start with doing it, let's say. Okay, other questions? Let's then go into the other part. So yeah, this is just practical guidelines for you. You're free to use it. I'm just sharing this with you. So a tool, maybe you already heard about it, is weights and biases. We used it heavily to do our experiments because we had a lot of data sets different models that we're trying to do. So it helped us very well to do this, to organize it. So it helped. Weights and biases in general can help you to do the experiment tracking, to do the hyperparameter tuning in a nice way, the data and model versioning, model management, and so on and so on. I'm not going to go over all these. I just want to show you, I pick one of several of them. The main parts and just show you how we use them. So how did I or we used weights and biases? It was more to organize the experiments. So to store the results in an organized way, the models to visualize quickly. And to repeat, maybe in some cases, experiments easily, and also to scale it to different servers or even clusters easily. So what you need to do is, you start by just creating an account and then install 1DB. That's a Python package in your environment. And then, yeah, from your environment, you can then log in to your account once you have a 1DB account with the API key that you can get from your account information. And then there is a way to just a command on the command line, 1DB login, and it will store something on your computer where, I mean, on your server in your home directory, maybe, where your script will be looking for, oh, he or she is authenticated. So you will need to do it only once, or if you maybe, but normally I do it only once and then you're set up and you can forget about it. So then how to start a run? You just import the 1DB, 1DB package, and then you initialize a project where you will log all your information for your experiments. How we did it, we put it in a separate script, which we imported in other scripts. So we, I mean, you're free to do other, but I'm just sharing how we did it. So we do the import in another script, we initialize, and there we also allowed for anonymous, because if other people want to use your code and they don't have a 1DB account, they can just use it anonymously. And then at least they can have the functionalities of this 1DB. They will, it will, I mean, the results will be to the 1DB server, or at least the accuracy, and then you can visualize them. Okay, and then you import this script from so in general you can just log in any, once you have this environment, you just log in any part of your script with the 1DB log function, maybe what you're interested in, maybe train accuracy, the loss, or in our case we actually implemented in, or we used PyTorch Lightning, and then you have some, I mean, not going into details of PyTorch Lightning, but in a nutshell, you have some functions you need to implement. And once these functions or methods, like training function, like evaluation function, once these methods are implemented, it's very easily to like attach a 1DB logger to it. It's just two lines of code, and then it will automatically, yeah, log your evaluation metric and validation metric, test metric, other things also. But without doing a lot of things will already be saved or logged. And then you get some, yeah, you can track your experiments on a user interface, graphical user interface online. You get something like that. And then, of course, one extra thing what is needed to, if you want to repeat or use your models in the next step, is you will also need to checkpoint your models, and this is also possible with some extra code here that you can, it will automatically checkpoint maybe the best model. If your accuracy improves, a new checkpoint model will be taken, and then yeah, you save some space, of course, because you only save the best models, but you can also save the intermediate models if you are still in a debugging phase. But I would say in production, yeah, you go to the best model, you keep the best model. And then another very attractive and powerful thing actually is the sweep. So this can be used for the hyperparameter tuning. So once you're script and model is set up and you're fine with it, of course you want to tune it, do some experiments with a lot of hyperparameters, maybe and other faults, different faults, and then it can of course blow up exponentially the number of experiments, and then you easily lose track of all experiments that you have running. So then you can organize them in a sweep. So in general, you can just, there are several ways you can use it for hyperparameter tuning, and then you can use like a Bayesian optimization hyperband, but you can also do a grid search of your hype. This is already built in, these kind of hyperparameter tuning in these kind of sweeps, you just, and then you just specify all the values you want to test. So it will look something like that. You create a sweep, you just create your configuration. Of course, it's not, you cannot see it, but just these lines are all the possible values you want for a specific parameter to test. And then you get, you launch the agent, you can launch them on different, so once you have your stack, your Python environment, and you on installed on different servers, you can just by one code launch an agent on the server, and then it will check your weights and biases server account to check, do I have more jobs to do for a specific sweep, and then it will start running new experiments, and it will just save the outputs to your account, and so you can scale easily to different servers this way. And then once all the experiments are done, the agent will shut down also automatically, so they will not keep on running. So that's a little bit in a nutshell how these sweeps work. So it's really powerful to scale, and yeah, it's like I said, it's just one line and you're done. You can start your whole experiment on a new server. So then you can follow up also these sweeps very easily. And then maybe to end, so also post-processing these sweeps. So remember, you were saving your best model with this checkpointing. Now you have some, you can easily with some code, extra code, you can extract these models again to do some post-processing. Maybe you want to use it for the next phase in your pipeline, or you want to test a specific metric. Your models are saved, and you can afterwards easily post-process them. So I think that was, in a nutshell, weights and biases. I think I ended on good timing. So let me just summarize. So weights and biases helps to track the experiments, to visualize, to scale easily, to post-process and rerun, and much more. So these were just some tips and tricks that I just wanted to share with you. But there is a lot of things that probably you will find out if you just use it. Okay, so I think that was it. Maybe some questions now.
I have a question about weights and biases.
Yep.
What is weights and biases? Supposing the stuff that you will put on the weights and biases, standards, you can be public or
so you can make it public, but normally by default is private for your account. But of course, yeah, it's the weights and biases service, or they have a copy of your model if you're in a if you're, but you can also download the weights and biases, I mean code, and set up your own server in your laboratory, and then of course the server is yours. But to get easily started, I mean, you can first start with the default functionality of the server, but you can also set up a local server easily. Yeah. Exactly. Sometimes. Yeah.
Do you know how you can compare with something like
Oh, how does it compare to Optunity or Optuna? Optunity.
Well, or
yeah. I'm not sure, but I think all the functionalities in these tools I recognize. Or I didn't do the test myself, but yeah, it combines, and I think more and more they will include other type of hyperparameter tuning. So I'm pretty sure that a lot of the main the most used methods are implemented there. Yeah.
Ah. Subset.
Okay.
Of the functionality, because this is mainly keeping all of your data online and organized and
checkpointed,
and you don't have this situation that I have.
And
now I want to load this model. I had this problem. I want to load this model to Sparken, but which version of Sparken in the deep was actually generated? And if you try to take it to the new version, it's crashes because I'm asked to change this to this. So now that rights are not there, so it cannot load the file. So it's like, and then what you are doing, and you try to figure out what was the saving date, so what was in there with the heat, and you spend half a day to figure out which version of your code was generated this file. So these type of problems can be solved.
Yeah, exactly. That helps a lot. Yeah. Okay. Okay.
Just get a short comment, because there was the question of R groups.
Yeah.
And there is another problem which, like, the name is avoiding me when you have like a group which is like, let's say, T, B, U, or partial visual. And that can be, I mean, practically implemented. So if you want to make a transformer to know them all, that's not possible. But if you make a method which detects the atom location, you can easily say, okay, I detect these atoms. This is something weird, which is not in my database. Probably it's this metal grouping. So I say, I cut this out and send it to an optical character recognition. I get the string, and then I check in a huge database that TBU means such a thing. So this is impossible if you just take a huge neural network, take the image out for the smile, and hope for the best. So this is one benefit of being like this interpretable. I think it's interesting.
Yeah, exactly.
On the graph, so like another question, like, did you test on Henry's modification?
We did some small tests, but
not systematically.
So
what happens is, I needed to draw a little bit carefully. Because you go for through an oxygen, and then the line is too far, then the guy believes that I actually already carbon, because carbon is the nothing. Yeah. So it sometimes can. But yes, I was. I didn't need to be too. Like after school of once, my neural network learned how to generate an image that kind of thing. So we formed the good version.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Yeah.
I don't know. Did you not make any chicken and just some like bone, like longer bones than usual, or
yeah, I mean,
or sometimes you know in patterns there, five number reasons like bone.
Yeah. So that's exactly the idea of this. I mean, this weakly supervised method, so that trained indeed on a specific source domain, and you have bonds like other styles, like maybe sometimes you have bonds like that to the stereochemistry is sometimes encoded in all kinds of styles. So, and then indeed, I mean, now we focused only on detecting the objects, like the atoms, but for the bonds you have the same problem. So the bonds, so I would say we didn't do the test yet for the bonds, but I would check if we can tackle the bond problem in the same way how we focused on the atoms. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.